So I'm Wolfgang and sitting here in Vienna, and also the company was founded here by myself in 2010. 2011 was our first sales. So it's 10 years now. And yeah, crazy. My background briefly also, I have some business background. I started business administration and also was working 3 years in marketing in a corporation after my studies. And yeah. Eventually got kicked out there, really. I mean, it didn't end well there. I wasn't the best employee either. But yeah, I was really then forced also because I lost the job basically. And the first idea was, okay, I don't want to look for another job. Just I want to try something out myself. And at the time I was already, I was into yoga since a few years before, like 2006, I think was my first yoga class I attended. And it was kind of a life-changing event. And I had this idea about that, doing a yoga teacher and training somewhere in India. And that was actually what I did after I also kind of lost my job. So I had a little, let's say, break of everything. And at that time, I really didn't have the mindset. I wasn't in this entrepreneur mindset at all. I maybe had some gut feelings that guided me and some ideas. And yeah, so the original idea, I would say, was also based on a product. So we had this first product, the yoga cushion. So these yoga meditation cushions that we still sell today, of course. The idea also at that point, there wasn't really a product on the market with those organic and gut standards that was sold on a large scale, especially. I mean, there were some small products that had organic fabrics, maybe. Right from the beginning, of course, this core idea to make a product that was more sustainable, but also in general, a product that was nice to touch, to smell, and yeah, so.
And that transition from your passion and teaching, I mean, what spurred you on to sort of make that decision to e-commerce? Was it demand from people you were teaching or was it just the sheer lack of options when you were trying to buy yourself?
Yeah, a little bit of that. I mean, also at the time I was doing also a vacation for some body work, and that's where the original deers came, these cushions that were not available in a way that I thought was possible to do, and then started off getting first ideas for the first product. And it took about a year until the first product really was ready to sell. And that's when it started.
And tell us a bit about that product as well. Like the cushion itself, from mine, I'm not the most flexible person in the world. And I've used the cushions before and I find them a bit easier than sitting on a bare floor to sort of get in a position that's comfortable and relaxing. Is that the principle behind the cushion?
Yeah, definitely. Basically, as a Westerner, you can't sit on the floor with your feet crossed. So you need to elevate your hips, basically. Otherwise, yeah. So you can at least sit for 10 or 15 minutes, which is good already.
Was there any concerns when you started an e-com business? What were the main ones?
If I would have known all the risk, I think I wouldn't have started. So it was quite naive when I started, I think. Looking back, it's crazy, yeah. But yeah, it was pretty crazy to just order from some manufacturer that you don't really know. So we had our first batch basically of cushion covers that we ordered from India. And yeah, we're hoping that they really arrive and that they're okay in quality and yeah, that everything works out. So if I would start all over again, I would probably do something a little bit more different or safer. Yeah. looking back, it was quite a risk looking back. But then also the demand. I mean, I didn't really know what the demand would be. And yeah.
I know that sustainability is one of the biggest parts for you as a business as well. Making an impact and giving customers what they're looking for. And also for us, we don't have a great or a big opportunity to be sustainable. We're a SaaS business. We work online. I guess we can look at the servers. But really, we're trying to shed light onto brands that are sustainable. Brands like yourself. And hearing what you do and how you do it. Why make your product sustainable?
Yeah, I started thinking when I founded a company that I wanted to make a product or have a product basically that is nice to feel touch and feel good about. So yeah, that was definitely one side of the story. And the other one also seeing the demand in the market and seeing the potential also to mass market an organic certified product. But it's probably also in the future even more our mission to not just promote our products, but also these standards, which are feasible, basically, would theoretically be feasible for any cotton product that includes cotton.
And do you think it's the consumer that needs to make the shift, or do you reckon the brands offering the products are the ones that have to make the biggest sort of commitment there?
Yeah, of course, both sides. I mean, consumers need an offer and also the value. I mean, that's something we try to combine we have to make also compromises on this way, because we still want to have products that are priced basically for mass market and compete with, I would say, conventional products. It's like when you go to the supermarket and have these organic private labels, for instance, that at least in Austria are really big. And so you can argue, it's still mass production, and it's at least organic, and it really lifts a lot of standards. And it's definitely a big progress. And also, it creates this awareness for the topic. And
a lot of sustainable goods, the implementation of reviews, allows you to have that social proof or that social value that a sustainable product is as good as, those mass-produced products that aren't as sustainable. Mm-hmm. Do you find the same sort of comments coming through in those reviews?
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't say specifically on the data. I wouldn't have some deep insights. But yeah, definitely what you're saying, is right. And probably could use, now that we have the flexibility, could also implement, it's a good actually idea I get now, that we could also ask these questions in the review when we ask the customers about how they feel about this aspect. So we have the flexibility also to add features and customized fields and features and questions in the reviews. And it's interesting. I also think the customer will feel more appreciated when he have these options. Just write your review and give you a star. I mean, if you give them some interesting questions that feel valuable, or I think they were more likely and happy to give the feedback if it's also something they feel is relevant for them and also then for other people. And this flexibility.
Yeah. So why did you choose, were you collecting with Trusted Shops before?
Yeah. Regarding reviews, we collected with Trusted Shops. We had the Trusted Shops badge originally. As you probably know, it was more like this trust over trust badge that was reached at the core function of Trusted Shops originally, that we were using quite some time, I think. And then later on, they started introducing this product review feature, which we actually really liked, because at that time we come from a history of selling on Amazon. So product reviews, even back then, 2015 was a big thing. Actually, it was the big time of Amazon product reviews and a lot of fake ones created at that time. So product reviews was a big thing that we knew from Amazon and from the websites. The typical online stores at that time usually didn't have any product reviews. So, and for us also, we had this store card system, and they had really some really bad functionality in getting customers to review products in a way usually set up, or even with some plugins that didn't really work. And then, actually we're quite happy with this Trusted Shops feature when they introduced it. The conversion rate was really high. So we're collecting a lot of product reviews as well, which also became the center for us more and more. Because we felt more and more, I mean, we are a strong brand, and also buying online is not just a big trust issue anymore, I would say. And that the bigger function important is actually the product reviews.
Yeah, that transition from company reviews, was the standard. I think once you get a rating and a feel, your customers get a feel for who you are, then it's really got to drill down into the products alone. Getting more and more information about that product is really going to help, was it as described, even though they may have amazing service, they want to review your products quite honestly and whether it's going to support them. Because I think reviews was at first like, can they be trusted? Will they send my goods and will it be damaged? That's what people are looking for. Whereas now, like you said, people are quite confident shopping, especially with the pandemic. Everyone's sort of shifted online, maybe had their first experience, and now they're wanting more information regarding products, whether it's going to suit their style, whether it's going to suit the classes they're going to be doing. So it's really, really interesting just to see that transition from company sort of content right through to, like you said, the product reviews and getting deeper insights into those. I believe you did a test, didn't you, with a Trusted Badge, an audience using the Trusted Shops and an audience using the Reviews Badge. How did that transpire?
The theory was that Trusted Shops, okay, in Germany, is more trusted because it's more known. So if we just would switch from a trust factor, just the Trust Badge itself, that we'll probably get less trust effect from review. But the test showed that basically it was not significant. And I think we had even a small uplift with the Reviews.io. batch, but it was basically not significant, which was for us enough because we felt feature-wise, we had more options, especially on product pages and all the flexibility regarding data and interfaces.
Yeah, it was nice to see. I remember the test on the A-B test and, you know, to actually, you know, firstly to do that test as well, because it's nice for us to say, look, we believe our badge is trusted, but then to actually see it firsthand was, you know, it's quite warming, you know, not to get, it wasn't a huge gain, like you said, but, you know, it's just an indication that trust isn't going to be lost.
Yeah,
and that value can still be passed on. One of our biggest concerns, you know, with companies changing the review partners is, you know, that understanding that you can migrate your review content across. Did you go through a process like that?
Yeah, of course. It was a big concern. I mean, I think I knew back when we actually signed up with Trusted Shops that at least their product reviews are really... basically our own data that we can migrate if we want. So that was at least my what I had in mind or what I was remembering, but we didn't know if it's going to really work out in practice. So of course there was some concerns. It was surprised also that this part turned out quite rather. Yeah, it was quite sweet actually. It was.
Did you have one of our guys do the migration for you? I can't
remember. Yeah, I mean, also we had Marcus, working our end from e-commerce, so I wasn't really much involved because it was working quite smoothly. It was not such a big issue as I had like anticipated.
That's really good to hear. Yes, yeah, it's something we always try to cover. I've got some questions here, and what's sort of next for Lotus Craft? Like, how do you go from where you are now? Like, how do you keep moving forward?
Parts. I mean, from the overall business model, we kind of migrating from being an Amazon private label brand, I would say, to a direct-to-consumer brand, I would say, with a strong position on Amazon, which is also, to me, a direct-consumer platform.
I speak a lot about that omnichannel approach, so you're looking more into that, making sure that you can make that transition from just Amazon to, you know, a channel where you can push your product feed into multiple places.
We always had this approach that we don't care what customers are buying. We just, and when they go to Amazon, we're going to want to give them the best experience, the same price, the same value, the same service, basically. And so when I look at our goals that we set, I mean, the website is really definitely more a center of our intention since about 2 years, I would say, especially since we also switched to Shopify. I don't know if it's a coincidence, but since then, I mean, it's really skyrocketed kind of also the sales.
Yeah, Shopify for us, like we always discuss, like what made you make that decision? Because we think Shopify is amazing. We have an approach of, you know, best of breed approach, which you look at holistically saying, well, you traditionally use Shopify, you'd use Klaviyo, you'd use Reviews and Gorgeous, you know, those sort of combinations. What were the considerations for you guys using, making that transition to Shopify?
It's fascinating because when you look at Shopify, or you can say compare the feature-wise with the shopping cart we had before, you could argue that we have less features now. And also there's some limitations in Shopify that are quite drastic, I would say, sometimes in some areas. What people underestimate on the other side is this effect of this cloud-based system and platform. It begins with a checkout. Before that, for the old shopping cart, we had so much development just for the payment process or payment provider integration and so on, updates. It was such a big issue in development. And you just go to Shopify and in 15 seconds, you have everything connected basically. And you never ever have to care. I mean, you can adapt if you want the checkout, but you can just leave the checkout as it is and it's working for the next 10 years. And it's going to be, maybe it's not the perfect checkout. You can argue there's a lot of things and it's not personalized, but it's just there and it can focus on Klaviyo, for example, Klaviyo is not something, these tools that are really dedicated to Shopify, also reviews always at the end that, for the previous shopping cart, you had to use some of the email marketing tools that were in the market and they're not as integrated and focused on Shopify. So we have a tool that gives you a lot of options, especially if you're not such a big brand, when we're growing, but if you have like 1,000 transactions per month, I mean, what's the point of customization when you have like one or two customers more? Because it's really, it has to be quite easy to start with, to start customizing with Klaviyo. I mean, it's very powerful, very simple. Whatever we realized also that just the focus shifted from developing our store and maintaining the store that did not crashing and everything's working from focusing on the marketing part.
It allows you to do the things you need to be doing and not focus on the pain points. And for us, you're exactly right. We're trying to make our products, you know, quicker to get, because how many times are you going to update them really? So really it's like we try to make, you know, our widgets as customizable as possible and, you know, as easy to use. So you don't need a developer like you would with Shopify. You can plug in and play. So everything has to talk to one another. As well as Klaviyo, we know how important that is. We have a good relationship with them. And we look constantly trying to say, well, we're experts in review marketing. They're experts in email marketing. So how do we combine the two? And the one thing I love about Klaviyo and the Shopify and the reviews integration is that it all talks to one another. You can use the data metrics so easily to talk to your customers at such a personal level.
Without Klaviyo, maybe we wouldn't be confident to... Because there also was one, I was very happy, like before Trusted Shops, finally we had someone taking care of this, that we get also some reviews and we don't have to deal about the technical side. But with this combination of Klaviyo and Reverse and Shopify, we were like confident, yeah, we can do it ourselves. And then of course we have in our hand, now we have, before all the emails were not with our branding, now we have personalized Lotus Crafts review requests and follow-up. And also we have all the, data, and even and that was possibly the legal way to use it for basic form for branding and marketing. Also this review collection process. So it's, and it's feasible. That's, I mean, that's probably also another, all other great email and personalization tools that try to combine all my data. But how much time do you really have to do it at the end? And it needs to also be feasible for an organization or a brand the size that we have to start with, and see the first results and success, and then you get really and it gets really exciting anyway, and you get a lot of potential and work ahead.
Fantastic.
Good to know.
Thanks for taking the call today, Wolfgang.
It's my pleasure.